Mina, konbanwa, JesusFreakinGamer here. Here is the 30-minute message, as I promised. It's a little bit on the late side, but that's okay. I'm going to make this happen. I said it was going to happen before Sunday, and doggone it, even though it's technically Sunday morning for me, it's Saturday night. The day is not over yet, and I'm going to get this 30-minute message in. And here it is, and covered the whole heaven thing, five-part episode. Really enjoyed doing that. The heaven thing was really good and outstanding. Hit a lot of stuff personal and in my heart, and definitely applicable to anyone and everyone interested in Christianity, in Jesus, and the ultimate reward there. And that was a wonderful time, and it definitely ties into all of who God is, his attributes. I decided to cover the omnis in a three-part message here, finally, at the end of the entire five-part heaven message, and after the first two omni messages, we are now coming around to God's omnipresence. And what that means is God is present everywhere simultaneously. He is everywhere at the exact same time. Obviously, we humans have really no conception of that. We can kind of like imagine it, but not really. There's nothing in this world that really compares to omnipresence. It is a concept really birthed out of the Bible, and it's mirrored a little bit in some other religions, not in the same way that Judeo-Christianity does it. So let's unpack that here, and this is going to be a full 30 minutes. I probably will go over just because I'm me. So let's get started. First off, as far as God's omni attribute, I think about the whole, you know, who God is in his attributes and who the Bible says he is. And omnipotent, all-powerful, when I think about it, that one kind of encompasses everything. Like, all-knowing, if you know absolutely everything, that doesn't necessarily mean you can do anything. If you are present absolutely everywhere, that also doesn't necessarily mean you can do absolutely anything. When you're all-powerful, it's kind of like that's the one power, where there's really no limit. Like, if you can do anything, does that mean you can go anywhere you want? Doesn't that mean you can be in multiple places at once? Doesn't that theoretically mean you could be everywhere at once if you're truly all-powerful? And if you're all-powerful, doesn't that mean you can know what he or she's thinking? If you're all-powerful, can't you make them think whatever you want them to think? Can't you make them do whatever you want them to do? Can't you make multiple people do whatever you want them to do? Can't you make multiple people think whatever you want them to think? Can't you make every single being in the entire universe, across multiple universes, in all parallel universes, in every single conceivable reality, time, and space? Doesn't your knowledge, doesn't your presence, doesn't what you're capable of doing transcend absolutely everything? So all the other two omni attributes of I'm getting a little tongue-tied here. Omnipresence and omniscience, they can kind of fall under the omnipotent category. But because anything that's omni, it's really a theoretical concept for us humans. We really don't have anything in this world that is omni-anything. There's nothing down here that can do anything, that lasts forever, that knows everything, or can even begin to input all data of all kind. Heck, mankind doesn't even know everything. If we were to take all of mankind's cumulative knowledge about all of history, we probably know less than 1% of all physical reality. And if there are multiple realities, well, my gosh, we know probably less than 0.0001% of absolutely all of reality. And the upper, you know, what is the upper bound of infinity? That's why infinity is a theoretical number. We can make believe it, we can theorize it, and it's actually very, very useful in certain mathematical circumstances where finite numbers just, they can't cut it because the calculations are so absolutely astronomically huge. And when you get on a universal scale, you will need numbers that are that big. But something that's truly infinite, that it doesn't quite compute with us humans. especially like for me particularly, this is a little bit of a tangent, but if we're talking about an all everything God, like, and one thing that I haven't covered, it may be worth covering, kind of like his all, he is omni time. There's not really an the three omnis that are always preached about are omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent. There's not really like, but we also say that our God is eternal, so he's like omni time. Or whatever, I can't think of a fancy word for time. I've never heard an omni-time. Insert word here that's appropriate and sounds fancy-schmancy. Omni-time, but he is. He's eternal. He has no beginning and no end. I can kind of get the no end part, like, you know, whatever happens now, it just kind of keeps going forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. And in math, we even have something called not a line, well, we have the line as well, but we have, blast it all, I forget that. I didn't look this up before the message, so on this part, I'm ill-prepared. I think it's, no, a point is just like the one dot. And I think the line is where it infinitely goes both ways. But there's one thing where it has a start and it goes infinitely in one direction. And that's something you learn in geometry. Then there is the line, which you also learn about in geometry. I wish I remembered the first one, but what I remember is the line, where it infinitely goes in both directions. There's no starting point. That's kind of the, it's hard for me to wrap my mind around personally, around no starting point. I can kind of get the no ending point, because at least you started somewhere, but to have no beginning or end is just like, huh? But a line mathematically is about the best I can personally conceive of when it comes to something that is infinite in both directions. And, you know, is time itself even linear? That's another calculation and computation for another time. Probably not one that will be covered by me. Mathematically, I'm not like incompetent or stupid, but math isn't my strongest suit. So I'll leave that to the mathematicians out there in the crowd. But so, yeah, how do you exactly define omni? What does that mean? And apparently God just fills in every single attribute that we could ever imagine, and even theoretically some that we cannot imagine. That is what being omni truly means. An infinite God in every single way, shape, and form. We can't, again, if we know less than 1% of all knowledge, or maybe even less than 0.001% of all knowledge, there are so many things that we potentially can't even know, like in our position in the galaxy as limited creatures who haven't been around that long, even though the people that, I personally don't believe in evolution, the people that do believe in evolution, however, would agree with me that human beings have been around for less than 10,000 years. So regardless of which party you're in, human history doesn't go much further back than that, and we simply do not have the capacity to understand everything that there is in our lifetime, indeed not even in multiple lifetimes. We're not going to get it all. We're never going to get it all. It's not going to happen for us. So reaching out to this infinite whoever, whatever, it's very much so beyond our capacity. That's why sometimes you'll hear Christians and preachers say that God is beyond our understanding. Well, the fullness of who he is certainly is beyond our understanding. But we can get glimpses, pieces, and parts. We may not know all of what it means to be all-powerful, all-knowing, everywhere present. We may not get any of those concepts to their fullest capacity. He very well could have attributes that we can't begin to understand here on Earth. If he's infinite, that's certainly possible. But we can get a glimpse. We can get a part. The fact that we can even conceive of infinity and conceive of omni, that's a step in the right direction. Now, I'm not trying to be vague. I'm not trying to, just lengthen this message out. I do a good enough job of that as it is. But since this is the last of my omni messages, or at least it's the last of the big three omnis, there are several other attributes of God I could cover in his nature, in who he is, kind of like who is he as a being, and what's he like. Those are kind of two separate categories. But the three omnis are the three big things that Christians, they kind of take for granted, they talk about, and whatever other capacities he has that are infinite, we don't append the word omni to that attribute. Therefore, here's the big three. So this is kind of a summary and a wrap-up. So I wanted to cover what omni means, how omnipresent fits into that. And to me personally, I wanted to cover omni in a little bit more detail because for me, omnipresent is a bit more nebulous than the other two. Like, I know what it means to have multiple powers, multiple abilities, multiple talents. The vast majority of humans can do multiple things well, and a few things, usually not just one thing, but a few things very well. And that kind of immediately goes into knowledge. Well, what do you know? Like, I'm a human being. I've lived 36 years on this planet. So I have learned a multitude of things. I have forgotten several of those things, my finer math points being one of them. So there are many things that I have learned. There are many things that I know. And there are many things that I believe based on what I know. Probably a few things based on just whatever. I do my best not to believe in things based on just whatever. I try to have a reason to believe the things that I believe, but I'm human. There are probably a few, I'm sure there are some loopholes, a few things that I haven't seen. Anyone watching this who's a non-Christian would be like, yeah, like the whole God thing. Yeah, good job there, buddy. Well, based on what I've seen, based on what I have learned, based on the evidence that I have taken in and processed, God makes the most sense to me. Jesus, the Christian God, makes the absolute most sense to me. And if you are watching it up to this point and you're not a believer, thank you so much for giving me the time of day. It is greatly appreciated. Back to the omnis. Omnipresent, though, I can only be in one place at one time. Everything that I can perceive and conceive can only be in one place at one time. Apparently, on the quantum level, things can be not omnipresent, but they can be in more than one place at the same time.
Oh, excuse me.
Like I said, it is a little on the late side, but powering through this is going to get this out to you guys. And quantum mechanics, quantum physics, that's certainly not something I've majored in. Wasn't taught it in school, and I don't have a huge interest in it right now, so I haven't looked into it. But according to some of my friends who have looked into it, on the quantum level, things can exist in multiple places at the same time. And that is, for me, that just breaks my mind. It breaks my mentality. How is that even possible? How does that work? How does it work? How is that even possibly a thing? I mean, I'm here. I can be there and here at the same time. It doesn't work that way. Apparently, on some level, it does. Apparently, there are some things that multiple presences actually explains in various avenues of science, at least according to my friends. I also know quantum mechanics and quantum physics and quantum sciences in general are still looked upon by the majority of the scientific community as quackery, as hocus pocus, as almost a religious belief in things that can't be proven demonstrably or consistently. And I could be wrong on this. I think a lot of quantum scientists admit that of their own studies. Like, yeah, a lot of this deals with theory. A lot of this deals with belief. A lot of this deals with non-provables. It just seems to make the most sense based on what we've seen. I do believe, however, and you can look this up behind me, could be wrong, but I do believe it's actually been shown. I don't know how or where, but I think it has been shown by certain quantum scientists that there are some things, certain particles, maybe atoms or cells or molecules, that have been demonstrated to be in two places at once. And again, I'm not sure if it's because they're moving so incredibly fast or if it's some mechanic that we don't yet understand, but it's like it's proven that they're in the same place or that they're in two different places at the same time, at the exact same time, and they are the same particle. How you prove that? I don't know. Hasn't been proven? Not exactly sure. I think it has been. For those who are curious, by all means look it up. So all of that to reinforce the fact that the omnipresent part, it breaks me. I don't get that. It's kind of like the line. It goes in both directions infinitely. If you have a starting point, I can get just you keep going and going and going. There's really nothing in this universe that is infinite. So it's still kind of hard to wrap my mind around, but going both ways, that's really hard to wrap my mind around. And the omnipresent thing is just, it's weird. I can accept the concept, but I don't really have anything in this life to base it on. Let's look at a few things that the Bible has to say about this particular concept. Let's go. The first one that comes to my mind is Psalm 139, 7 through 12. And again, I'm going to flip through the Bible pages. I invite you to join me along on this journey. Again, I just love the flipping of the pages, like in the churches of days gone by before cell phones existed. I'm 36, remember. I'm old. So Psalm 139, verses 7 through 12. This is a psalm of David. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where could I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall fall on me, even the night shall be light about me. Indeed, the darkness shall not hide from you, but the night shines as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to you. And this is David speaking under the influence of the Holy Spirit. Backing up to verse 6, he says, such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it. So he is saying that he is getting this information from the Holy Spirit, that this is divinely inspired. This isn't just David's thoughts or opinions on the matter. He's saying this is divinely inspired information, that God's presence is in multiple places at once, and that he will be with his servant wherever he goes. And that kind of motif of going wherever he goes with all of his people, you can find a similar thought back in Genesis 28, 15. Genesis chapter 28, verse 15. This is God talking to Jacob here. It's Abraham, Isaac, and then Jacob. Genesis 28, 15. Behold, I am with you, God talking to Jacob, and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. And now God has said this to all of his servants. You read the biblical message, you read what the Bible has to say in regards to various people. It is like always God's promise. He'll be with his servant from beginning to end. And he can do that with multiple servants at the same time. How do you do that? By being omnipresent. You can be in more than one place at once. You're not just like hounding or tracking one person. No, you're already there. And I can also move on to a little bit of Paul's theology. If we go to Acts chapter 17. Acts chapter 17, verses 26 through 28. He is speaking at the Areopagus. Hopefully I said that correct. Close enough. Acts chapter 17, verses 26 through 28. Paul speaking. And he, that's God, has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings, so that they should seek the Lord, in the hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us, each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as also some of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. So he wants all people to seek for him in the hopes that they will find him, and he isn't far from all of us. All of us can find him. In fact, we are where he wants us to be. He's put us in a position where we can seek and find him. Like, for example, you're watching this video. You're hearing this message. You're in a position, a unique position right now, where you can hear from the Lord. You can hear his thoughts on who he is. You can find the Lord, and I will indeed lead a little message at the end of this, or lead a little altar call at the end of this message, so you can indeed come to know your Creator, God Almighty. And not only can we all seek him, and he's not far from each of us, in him we live and move and have our being. Now that sounds kind of weird. Again, the whole nebulous, he's everywhere at once, okay. But then again, if he's literally everywhere at once, that means like I'm literally sitting in him right now. I'm also sitting under him and above him and beside him on both sides and all the diagonals. I'm literally inside God. And so are you. Because in him, we live and move and have our being. All of us can seek and find him. So that kind of brings out a little bit more of his presence. Not just the lost, or I'm sorry, not just the saved, not just his chosen people. everyone. God wants everyone to seek him, and everyone can find him. I think I will go back and cover those real briefly, even though it deals with believers. So that's a spot on just everybody in the world. There are more spots in the book of Matthew where God, Jesus specifically, God, the God-man, talks about being with all of his people. And again, you can't be in two places at once unless you're God, unless you are something that has definitely transcended human existence. So Matthew chapter 18, verse 20 is the first one. And this is a very famous verse. If you've been in church for any length of time, you've probably heard this before. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them. Like, he's actually there. And technically, he, according to Paul, he's there for not just his people, but and not just for a group of people, a group of his people. He's there for everybody. So if Paul and Jesus' words are both taken to be true, that means he is everywhere at once, but there's something special about when two or three are gathered in his name. And that's... Again, that is also, once again, another topic, an entirely different topic. But there's something special about two or three gathering in his name. And then at the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28, let's get to the very, very end of Matthew, the last verse in Matthew. Jesus giving the Great Commission to his 12 disciples. Or I'm sorry, at this point, the 11 disciples before the 12th one was chosen. Matthew 28:20, Jesus speaking, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. So he's with all of his people. Period. Forever. No exceptions. And this is Jesus in his resurrected form here. First statement, he hadn't risen from the dead yet. Of course, he was going to. He knew he was going to. And here he's risen from the dead. So even though Jesus has now a flesh body that apparently we're going to share with him in the resurrection, that's covered in my heaven message. A little self-plug there. Self-promo awesome. Even though he's in a flesh body that's glorified. It's like ours. It can touch things. It can interact with things. We can physically see it. It can eat. But he's still everywhere at once. So again, my mind's just like, okay, there's obviously not Jesus flesh everywhere. How is he everywhere at once? Well, somehow is the only answer I could come up with. Apparently in the same way God the Father and God the Holy Spirit are. So even though he is a flesh being now, Jesus is still in some way. Obviously, his flesh isn't right here. I don't see it. You don't see it. I can move around without touching skin or various parts of the human anatomy. I'm not touching anything. I'm just touching air. But Jesus is right here. He's right there. He's right there as well. So to wrap, I'm about to wrap this up to kind of bring this in, to kind of bring this concept in best as I can. The way we can all seek him, the way we can never get away from him, the way he's with all of his people, his presence, who he is, fills everything. And to that, I have two last verses. First is 2 Chronicles 6:18. 2 Chronicles chapter 6, verse 18. This is Solomon's dedication prayer of his temple. But will God indeed dwell with men on the earth? Behold, heaven and the heaven of heavens cannot contain you. How much less this temple which I have built? So, God's presence is everywhere. Nothing can really hold him or contain him. And then Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 3. And these are the seraphim crying out, heavenly beings. And Isaiah is seeing them in a vision around the throne. And one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. The entire earth is filled with the glory of the Lord. The whole earth. And that's a little bit of a stretch. Because the earth seems to be full of sin and violence, darkness, fear, despair, death. At same, so this verse for me requires a bit of faith. At the exact same time, God knows what's going on. God is right there in the middle of the horrible thing. So when I say, and when preachers say, that God is with you in the middle of your circumstances, we mean quite literally. You can't get away from His presence. He is literally right there, whether you want Him to or not, whether you want Him to be or not. He hears every single thing you say. He sees every single thing you do. And because He's also all-knowing, He knows all those things that go through your mind and your heart that no one else knows. And maybe you kind of just, you yourself glossed over or didn't pay much attention to it. God knows. He didn't miss it. He doesn't just know from afar like some, you know, giant telescope looking from the heavens. No, He was right there in person and in your mind and in your heart. God's literally everywhere. There's no escaping Him. He's right there. For those who don't like Him or like the thought of being, I guess, spied upon, that's some bad news, because you cannot ever get away. But for anyone who knows Him and loves Him, it's the best news in the world. We are literally never alone. Never. He'll never leave or forsake us. By the way, last reference there, Deuteronomy 31:6 and Hebrews 13:5 and 6. The very famous lines, "I will never leave or forsake you." Look at those two verses. In Deuteronomy, he's talking to the nation of Israel. But in Hebrews, the author of Hebrews applies that to every single believer. And as Paul mentioned earlier, and as Isaiah mentioned, and Solomon mentioned, His presence actually extends absolutely everywhere. And David even mentioned if he were to go into the depths of hell, even there, God's presence exists in some form. God knows what's going on in hell. You cannot get away from this guy. And He loves you so much. He came in the form of Jesus Christ and died on the cross for your sins, shedding His blood so you could be forgiven, and then rose again 3 days later to guarantee you eternal life in heaven. You can't get away from Him, and you don't want to. He loves you so, so much. You were created for His pleasure, and you were created to experience His joy and His pleasure of you and in you forevermore. That was the design. That was the intent. And through Jesus, that can still be realized. What Adam and Eve lost in the garden, Jesus reclaimed on the cross. And we can have that right now. Right now. And He's right there. If you pray, He'll hear you. You may not answer the way you want Him to in every circumstance, but there's no way He's going to miss your prayer. He hears the things you don't even want Him to hear. So He definitely hears the things that you want Him to hear. The heart cries, the pleas for help. And hey, maybe even the thank yous. Today's a good day. I feel good. Life's good. Thank you, God. A little bit of praise, a little bit of thankfulness is a good thing. He hears that too. So guys, right now, if any one of you is not a Christian, you've listened to this, to the entire message up to this point, first, thank you so much. Second, I'd like to invite you right now to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. This joy and this peace that I have and that other believers have, which you may or may not have seen depending on the believers you've known. Sad, unfortunate truth. Not every Christian lives up to the expectations that our God has for us. And heck, I'm a huge failure. I have failed on so many fronts, as I've confessed to in several of my YouTube videos. But sometimes we Christians get it right. And whether you've seen us get it right or not, some of you have seen us get it right, and you want what we have, and you can have it right now. Some of you may have never seen it. I can only tell you that there are Christians who do love it. There are Christians who do care. There are Christians who give a crap. They try. They really want to serve their God correctly. And they're really trying. And if you look, you have internet access if you're seeing this message. If you look, you will be able to find them. I'm not the only one. Even if there are none around you, they do exist. And more importantly, God's around you. And He loves you. Despite the failures of His church, He'll never leave or forsake you. And He will always love you and never leave you and never fail you. Won't you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior right now? And if you want to, just tell Him exactly that you want Him as your Lord and Savior. that you want your sins forgiven and that you believe he died on the cross for your sins and rose again 3 days later. And if you want a model prayer to follow after, pray this prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I admit I'm a sinner. I need your forgiveness and your grace. I believe you died on the cross for me. I believe you rose again. Please forgive me. Please be my God, my Master, my Savior right now. Thank you, Lord, for hearing this prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you prayed that prayer and you meant it and you wanted it, you got it. You're saved. You may not be seeing lights or, you know, hearing explosions in the background or anything like that, but if you prayed that with all your heart and you meant it, you are right now a Christian. It counted. It took. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. And congratulations! Welcome to the family of God. It is good to have you. If I can encourage you, start reading this. Start reading this book. Just like a chapter a day. And if you don't have time for a chapter, just a few verses a day. If you want to get to know who your God is, learn a few more of his attributes, and what he thinks on various matters and things in this life, the Bible is going to be your best bet at learning what he thinks and how he wants you to think, because you're now his child. And things are a little bit different now. You don't just get to do everything you always wanted to do. You do get his love, you get his freedom, you get his joy, but there are things that you really shouldn't do. It's called sin. A lot of that's what you just repented of. You don't want to go back to that. So read the Bible. Get to know what your God thinks. Also, you'll get to learn how to stay out of that sin that you wanted to get out of just now when you prayed that prayer. Also, try to find a Bible-believing church. Find a group of people who believe in Jesus like you, who believe that the Bible is the Word of God, and find some people that will just encourage you and strengthen you in this walk in Christ. It's not always easy and it's not always fun. But because we know him, and because he's always with us, he'll never leave or forsake us, and we have heaven to look forward to at the end, it is a worthwhile journey. It'll pay off in the end. Also, one last thing, pray just a little bit every day. If it's as simple as, God, thank you for the day, or God, help, this day sucks, those prayers count. He hears them. He's right there. And you don't even have to say them out loud. If you simply think that prayer, that's a prayer shot up to God. It counts. He heard it, and he's on it. Guys, thank you so much for watching this episode. And for anyone who's watched this entire series, thank you so much. Thank you for giving me the time of day and hanging in there with me. Hopefully this has been a blessing and encouragement to you. I love each and every one of you. God bless.